Hey, Joey guys. Is recording. Hey, you're recording.
Bonjour,
man.
Bonjour.
I'm recording.
Hey, bonjour. Are you a fan of France? Of the football team?
No, are you? Did you like the match, Jokke?
I didn't see it. I only saw the Dutch game and the Belgian game.
Is that the only one
I didn't. I didn't see any games as well. No. Good topic.
Okay.
So tell us Germany, Ralph. Like, what do you think?
I didn't see it. I didn't see it.
What about their team?
Did you see the Holland game? Did you like it, Jopke?
It was a very bad football, I thought. But we won, nonetheless. And we almost even got a tie. So it was a close call. But we're lucky we're in this shitty pool with Holland. Else we would have been thrown out faster than you can say Euro 2020.
Yeah, so you think all the countries that are in our pool are shitty?
They're amazing countries, but football-wise, not so much.
Well, I gotta say,
Holland is a shit country football-wise. So
I liked how the Ukraine played. They maybe don't have the players that play with the big teams. Although I gotta say, I was very well surprised by the right winger. I liked their striker as well. He was very good in possession, especially. They all could play a ball to him, and he always had the ball.
What position is striker?
The spits.
Spits.
Oh, is it striker?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I liked their midfielder, Zinchenko, a lot. I think he might be the best player on the pitch that day. And but I kind of liked some players in the Dutch team as well. I think Dumfries played a very good game. And
that makes me laugh. That makes me laugh.
Yeah,
why not?
It was
a terrible game of him. I couldn't watch it. I was like surprised how bad he played, and like how many chances also in the first half.
Yeah, I agree. And
remember, you gotta ask yourself this. Would everybody get that chance, or is he like near brilliant in his position play that he could play himself that free? I think that's the question. Also, all three goals, he was involved. The third one he made, and the first two, it came from the right. There was so much danger from the right, and I like that. He never stopped walking. He ran the whole time. I think he's your worst nightmare if you play against him. And also the danger from the Ukraine came from the other side, from Yarmolenko. He was the most dangerous player on the... right winger.
If you said Dumfries is the most dangerous player, that could be, but then it's still not that dangerous. I think if you compare it to like other teams and other big players, and yeah, you can be on the right spot, but then you still need to score the goal. It's very simple. It's like, yeah, you can be on the right, walk on the right spot all the time, but you missed. They missed. I think they got the most chances in a half in the Euro Cup ever. And then there's no goals. That's insane.
I also like Van Aanholt on the other side as well. To be honest,
I thought he was a bit lazy at times. Like not running, and I think it's also part to do with the game, like the system they have.
Because who did you like most at the Dutch side?
Frenkie probably. Frenkie was like saw everything. Only thing is, he's been like every time Frenkie de Jong had the ball, there were like two Dutch guys around him because that's their line, the system. And nobody knew where to run. They didn't create any spaces. And
so you didn't see the rushes that Frenkie did where he lost possession and he was battling himself. He was so frustrated. I didn't like him at all.
Yeah, but I think it's mostly the system. I think he did still see everything and he just couldn't go anywhere. And like there's every time he had the ball, there were like two Dutch players right by him. Yeah, you can
pass okay,
the ball
so
to him,
you're
that
now
makes no sense.
Looking at a game and how somebody has played, and then you're saying he probably would have played a way better game if the system was different, and then saying, so he did a very well job?
No, you ask who did the best for you.
Yeah.
I'm not saying he played a good game. I'm saying he did the best for the Dutch team. As you said, Dumfries is the most dangerous. Well, I didn't think he was dangerous at all, but he is the most dangerous of the game. Yeah,
he scored a goal, and it was his two times. It were his four centers. Still,
and if you have a header, and you have the ball, and you always have to look where the ball goes. This is a tip, Dumfries, if you're listening. If you look past the goal, like next to the goal, the ball will go there. So try to aim within the posts.
Do you play football, Jopke?
I'm very bad at football.
okay. Yeah.
Very bad at football, yeah. But it's like, yeah, that doesn't mean I can't comment on...
Of course.
Dumfries or anything.
Yeah, but I think somebody who plays the game is better suited to... I think so. You can go now.
No, but we talked about this also in music. It's a nice bridge for the
music. Yeah, I like this bridge.
I like that anyone, like my mom, can say, "Hey, Jopke, your song is shit," and she can have a very valid point, although she doesn't know anything about music. And I think that's the same for anything.
But that's just her opinion,
if I
right?
say to Dumfries. Yeah, it's always an opinion.
Yeah.
But if I say to Dumfries, "Hey, you played like shit," and he's like, "Yeah, so who are you?" Then it's a dumb response.
But he could add, "So who are you to say?" Because the first two goals, they came from my foot, and then I scored the winning goal.
Yeah, but so
goal.
Are you to say? That's like some pride, that's some ego, that's not necessary. He could
no.
say, "Well, yeah. I don't agree." Then we can agree to disagree, but it's always a bit weird when someone is like, "I'm so famous and well known for this."
But
who
to be
are
honest,
to
what I always notice is that for me too, I think Frankie is one of the best players we have right now, and I love him. I also love him as a person. I think he's a very cool guy. But this match wasn't his match, and. It was Dumfries' match. He played a very good game. Okay, he did miss two very good chances, but he got in that position every time again, and it resulted in three goals. You cannot say he played a shit match. He did a very well job. He made sure he got in that position, and he made the goal, the winning goal eventually. Yeah, how can anybody say he did play? If I just look at that match, he did a very well job. I cannot conclude any otherwise.
Yeah,
anything else.
I think what happens when I watch football, I think you're more of like, hey, they had so many chances and this is where he was. I just look at what's happening every time, like more at the single situations. And I think there were some fuck-ups that just shouldn't happen at that level, I think.
We can conclude, and that's also, you have two types of persons. The one who look at the negative and the one who look at the positive. I'm the glass half full guy who looks at the positive things, and you're the glass half empty, the negative guy.
Okay,
that's
okay,
the
okay.
conclusion. That's okay.
Well,
I respect
agree to
that.
Disagree.
Oh yeah, nobody wants to be called looking at the negative, but yeah, I cannot conclude any otherwise. Yeah.
Well,
you just said it yourself. I'm looking at the fuck-ups. Yeah, well, I'm not.
No. I'm looking at the situations and how the overall game was. There were way more fuck-ups than good plays, so to speak. And I think that's just... It's a shame, you know?
What about the rest of the games? 6-0.
And I did like how Ukraine, they were able to play such a high tempo with just touching the ball maybe often one, sometimes two times. I really liked how they sometimes played away from the pressure that Holland was doing. I gotta say, I'm very curious how the Netherlands will operate when they are being under high pressure. When they play, for instance, a team like Germany, then they will get under high pressure. And I'm not so very sure. I also think Frankie will excel then, but we have to wait and see. But yeah, that will be the real test when they play somebody who will pressure you from the get-go instead of Ukraine. That I think the Ukraine, you noticed when they were 2-0 behind and they did pressure, they scored two times.
But can we talk about those goals and how perfect those goals were? Like
Yarmolenko's, I think it's the goal of the game right now.
It was
now.
Sick. Yeah. It's like it one of those really goals, sick. Like amazing, perfect shot. Yeah. I do think it's a little bit of a fuck up. It was from the defense because there were two guys on him and they were both like, "Where the fuck's this guy going? It's your guy." They didn't know who should follow him, so he could like easily walk out of that situation, so to speak.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
then he made that super shot. So and then the other goal was just yeah, like textbook.
I didn't like the substitutes either when. It was Nathan Ake came in. He wasn't sure. I really liked Timber, by the way, young guy. I think he had this piece when he was on the ball. I really liked that as well. And I liked Van Aanholt better than who was the winger that the Wijndal. He was also, but yeah, I gotta say it's always hard to come in a game, and then when you start, you can grow into a game. And but I didn't like the substitutes. I think the Bonds coach, the coach, he did a very bad job because you saw
Frank the Farmer.
Frank the Farmer, yeah. Man, I gotta say he has the charisma of a stone. What the fuck, man? Maybe I do too.
I like,
by the way,
I thought there should be like we were watching the match and then you see him sometimes looking at something. It was like 2-2, and I just started like. Pretending to be him, like as a sketch, like two. They also have two, and he looks like this. Like,
yeah,
they also have two. That means we get 1 point. that's how he looks to the whole game, and he's like,
yeah,
he's like, what's going on?
I'm not a big fan of him, to be honest. No.
It's so weird that when his eyes, when he smiles, his eyes still look angry, but his mouth smiles.
Yeah,
like it's two different emotions.
He doesn't need sunglasses, I'm sure of that, because I already have those eyes a little bit back in my skull, but his eyes are way back. It's sick. Yes, yeah, like, this is Frank de Boer.
I think it's a super hard job, though, to be the coach for like a national team.
No, it's the easiest job ever.
But don't you think the pressure you get?
Yeah, I see it here.
Comes
Joey
with a lot of pressure.
Is a glass half empty, and here Ralph again is a glass half full. It's easy.
You're right. Yeah. Well, I think no. The pressure is immense, but it's not a hard job to do.
Well, yesterday there was an interview with Van Basten. That was about being like coach of a national team and how he experienced it. And there was also this football player, Afalai. And they talked about the pressure they have and that they experience as football players as well during those tournaments and games in general before you go into that arena full of people.
Yes.
And he was mentioning that when Afalai mentioned that when he was playing with Messi at, I believe it was Barcelona.
Yeah.
Messi, before every game...
He vomits.
He vomits from the pressure.
I would too, yeah.
Yeah, but if you think about it, like, if you compare it to an artist, you know, like, if you go on stage, it's kind of the same thing, like going into the arena or going on stage.
Yeah.
I don't think that's a healthy... It's not healthy in any form or way, because you can say it's a healthy dose of excitement before I go on, or a healthy dose of nervousness before I go on. But the amount of stress you get from that you're that you're literally vomiting, that's not healthy.
I don't, I agree. But yeah, we are wired all in such a different way. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I'm glad that Messi chose to still play football, even though he's that nervous game. Because in my eyes, he's the best footballer we've ever seen on the pitch.
And that was the discussion. They said, like, if a player like that, who has crushed every record possible, who have played every game possible, every tournament possible, if a player like that is still experiencing that amount of pressure while he literally has to prove himself towards no one.
Yeah.
Then how hard is it? Is it possible as a human?
Not towards no one.
Yeah, but is it possible as a human to be?
It's very
to get used to it.
No, I think it is very unhealthy, and it's like the price you pay to be the best, I guess. Mm-hmm. I think the same goes for Hartwell when he became number one. It was like, okay, now every time I go on stage, they expect that stage will blow up and like everybody will be like, it will. And then if you play an average set, people will be disappointed. Mm-hmm. And that's the same for Messi, where when he didn't excel at last time the World Cup, and because maybe he had a shitty team around him, then it's like, yeah, Messi didn't really perform. And then that pressure is always going to be there, I think. And I think you can't get used to it, because it's same for Ronaldo. You always expect, hey, Portugal, Ronaldo has the ball, and he doesn't score. Like, what? It's
Well, it's a good bridge to the mental health issues. I think for everybody who has to perform, we are all wired in some kind of way, and of course you can learn to cope with a lot of things. Everything can be learned as well, but still, the one has a more natural ability to do the one thing, like performing, and the other one is, I mean, we're all also producers who can sit in a cubicle like this for 10 hours straight. That's not for everyone as well, but you can still learn that. But I think also for a footballer or an artist, what's really important, even for an entrepreneur, that you gotta know yourself mm-hmm. and be really honest to yourself how you are wired, and also face that, you know, that you have those weaknesses and strengths, and live with those and cope with them and try to manage that. I think that's one of the most important things. In the case of Messi, it's weird that you have to vomit. I don't think there's a management in that.
Vomiting could also be his way to cope with it. Sometimes you get so nervous, and maybe that's his way of releasing some pressure, like a self-release. but I think that could actually be some kind of coping mechanism, and he feels... Probably way better.
I would vomit so bad. I would vomit on the pitch.
The problem is that vomiting is kind of like the last resort. If your body is rejecting and starts to vomit, then it kind of tells that you're mentally not able to cope with everything what's going on. So your body literally starts to take over.
Is that a panic stage? I'm not sure, because you can
smell-ish. It's like a panic button, yeah.
I think it could be that automatic reaction of his body, but it could also be that he triggers it himself and wants to vomit, because there's also people who smell like licorice and they have to vomit, so it's like...
It becomes a trigger, you mean?
Yeah. It's not like...
Like a gag reflex.
Yeah, something like that. So I'm not sure if it's really like physically...
Yeah, I'm not sure if it works for him or if it doesn't, but I was listening to that story, and it made me think about myself, but also about other artists and football players, like everyone who works in a field of high pressure. I was just surprised that a guy like that, with the experience that he has, like how many matches did he play already? You kind of should know what you're getting
500?
Into. I don't know, but you kind of should know by now what you're getting into if you walk into that arena. But still vomiting every game. I don't know. I was kind of surprised.
I don't know if he still does it. Could be in those years.
Yeah. We also can admit, I think, that playing sports at that level isn't really healthy at all, or not at all, but like there's some part of it that's very unhealthy, because you're always constantly pushing your body to the limit. Of course, we saw what happened. I'm not sure saying it comes from this, but we saw what happened to Ericsson, which was terrible. And it happens to some other athletes sometimes, where their hearts just stops, and it's like
that's what I was thinking as well. Like, this is number three, right?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, but you
think
maybe about,
even more. But
three think about
there are way more.
About.
There are way more. Apparently, you lost my connection or something. Yeah,
something like that. Yeah.
Okay. No, I was telling. You hear a lot of guys that are, that are experiencing heart problems now, like Daley Blind and Nouri. Those are familiar cases in Holland. And now this again. Yeah, it's. curious, to say the least. Yeah,
I wonder if it has something to do with the amount of, like Jay said, like the amount of pressure you ask from your body every day. Like you need to get the max out of it every day.
Yeah. Or maybe it's also that the pressure is more continuously, because when you were 20 years back, you played a match, and then you had the TV programs that said shit about you. But now it's continuously with socials and all the stuff, and you get bashed or appraised all the time, and it goes. The roller coaster is like it's leveraged now, you know.
What I'm wondering, and maybe you guys know this, but I know a few guys from Willem II, like the local football club here, and I've been talking to them. Like, is there any form of coaching guidance that has been offered to you to cope with these kind of things, like social media, for example? How do you deal with the pressure on Twitter, on Instagram?
I have a very simple tip for if you're dealing with pressure from social media. It's called turn your all your screens off. Turn your phone off and don't look at it. I think we've come to this part where and I still try to convince myself, which I don't like, that we need all this social media shit. I think we don't. It's a very handy tool, but you definitely don't need it in life. So that's like a number one tip. Also, to come back more at your question, is when when DJing became my job, social media was relatively new. And like, I remember Martin Garrix blowing up on Instagram and Facebook, and it was like unique. We never saw that. And it's like, whoa, he's getting this many likes on one photo. So no one knew, also around him, and basically no one really knew how to deal with that. And I think that's why we never learned. We learned by guiding ourselves, basically, because
there someone like, and the same goes for Martijn, of course. When I started doing artist coaching, I kind of started doing it also because of this. Like, I never had the idea that there was some sort of guidance or some sort of coaching that could help artists deal with this. But at the same time, also the thing that Ralph mentioned, like finding out how you work yourself, like what's important to you, what do you like, what do you don't like. Those are all things that we don't learn on school, and you have to find out by yourself. And most of us don't, and have to find out the hard way by getting in burnouts, depressions, whatever.
Hard way.
And then I also heard it from the hard way. Yeah. and then I also heard about it in like the football world. Like they experience similar things as an artist experience. But I was wondering, like, is there any guidance in that field?
Yeah, in the big football clubs, yes. The smaller ones, they just simply don't cut in budget.
Yeah.
Although I think it should be a lot of. We are in the this right here is all in the big Mandenmaker Stadion in Waalwijk, the home of RKC. No, for yeah, we are. We have our office in a football stadium. For a small club in a small town, but still they play on the highest level. And a good friend of mine is the director right here. And but also when he still played football, I always could level really good with him, because those pressures and all the stuff around it, pretty similar to being an artist. And also there are so many things that come into play, like almost everybody around you who know you, they are always kind of joke about it, you know, and they only see the simple stuff, and they don't recognize that there are so much pressures and impressions coming at you. And I think it would be a very good thing. But also, I mean, coaching and as an artist, and usually an artist first looks, I need a label, I need a booker, I need a manager, but they never think about, I need a coach. No. More and more, because unfortunately there have been some incidents also, way too many incidents in the dance scene as well. And I think staying sound up here is so important for when you are under a high pressure or high visibility, maybe that's more. Also, if I speak for myself, I think the more one of the most dangerous things we experience as artists is that through social media, the world doesn't stop at 5:30 when you go home to eat. No, it's a continuous thing. Mm-hmm. And then you go home and you sit on your couch and you want to relax, but no, then you see a competitor doing this or a competitor doing that. And then and you think, oh, that's a good... It goes on and on and on. The bow never diffuses. And of course, Jobke says very wisely, turn off your screens. But on the other hand, especially I think for upcoming artists, it's hard to do. Yeah, because... Yeah. It's one of those things that can get you out there. Internet's the one of the it's like 90% responsible for Basechecker's success. Without it, we wouldn't be here. And it's simple as, and you got to work it as well. But it's hard to work it and being, and you got to work it, but be conscious about it. And
I think... It's just a question of at what cost do you want to break through? What part of your private life do you want to give up? That's of course a question as an artist. You're going to have time away from friends. Also with your social media, I would suggest if you really want to focus so hard on it, just give yourself like time slots in the day. Just say, hey, at 8 p.m. I'll make sure to check for an hour or half an hour and post and whatever and respond, and then I put it away. I think managing, and I think what is a great tip is reading a lot of books about this. I know if you have book requests, Joey always has good tips, but just reading books about managing the stuff you want versus the stuff you need, because you don't really need that much, you know, to be like in a good place mentally.
You can compare social media to a bad habit, just as smoking, for example. And the first and easiest thing you can do to cancel out a bad habit is by taking away the trigger.
Yeah.
And by smoking, for example, in most cases that is simply having the package in your pants, so you can just take it and grab a cigarette, you know. So simply stop buying cigarettes is the easiest way to delete that habit. Same goes for social media. Like I did the same thing. I noticed that I spend a lot of hours on social media because I make a lot of content and I have to be there to build my business. But the problem is once you start posting things, you start seeing other people's content and you end up scrolling 5 minutes and you just lost 5 minutes of your life. So what I ended up doing is simply taking away the trigger, because I believe social media is here to stay. It's not going anywhere. You can use it to build your brand as an artist. I believe you have to use it because it's the easiest way to do it these days. But that doesn't mean you should go and experience the bad sides of it. So what I did is I simply started unfollowing everyone. So that when I go to Instagram, I can still post everything, I can still update everything, whatever I need to do to build my brand or to keep stay in touch with my fan base or whatever, or the community. But I don't see any other people's content. So it's not interesting for me to stay there because I only see my own stuff, which is boring. So there's no trigger for me to stay there. And then when I have done the things I should have done, like posting stuff or whatever, I just leave because there's no reason to stay.
So you don't know what Gary V is doing?
No, really not. Like I can show you. Oh. No, here.
I think he doesn't follow him.
Oh, yeah. Can you press the looking glass or the?
Yeah, this is just what they recommend.
Where are all the boobs, man?
Yeah.
I don't watch it.
Okay, that's also a big problem.
No, but just to give a simple tip for people, if you really feel like, hey, I am aware of the fact that I need social media because I'm a starting artist or I'm an established artist and I need to maintain the relationship with my community, but I do know and experience that a lot of my time, I kind of get drawn into this rabbit hole every time I open up Instagram or whatever. Simply start unfollowing everyone. And then also you don't have the problem of being on the couch at night and seeing your competitor uploading something that could...
It's all... the whole of social media is all about FOMO, the fear of missing out, which is a very annoying emotion. I guess I call it...
It's what drives the world nowadays.
Yeah, exactly. I see my friends... Oh, they're at the park. I'm in the studio. Why am I in the studio? I want to go to the park. I'm missing out. They're having this party. Hey, wait. Timmy Trumpet has a booking again. Why don't I have a booking? You know? And I think it's taking time away from that, realizing it's not all real anyways, and just managing those emotions, so to speak. I think that's also what we don't really learn every time, like in school or whatever. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of things coming at you and like you feel shit, like you feel very annoyed about something and you don't know why. You want to understand why and you want to be able to put it aside. You want to, you can't really remove bad feelings or whatever, but just you gotta learn and work on it to like not let it distract you too much from your work. And I think that's something that goes for everyone, and I think it's weird if I think about it that we don't learn this in school, because your brain, it can be a dark place, you know, especially for
that's true. But I gotta say, whatever, the things, if you want something exceptional, you have to make exceptional effort. Mm-hmm. You have to also make sacrifices.
Yeah,
you gotta do the extra work. It's that simple. Mm-hmm. It doesn't come on its own. If I look now in my timeline, I see so many also artists or whatever being in the beach or Dubai and Ibiza, just name it. They're not working. And to be honest, I'm thinking, what? How can they be so chill?
You can never know what they're doing. That's also the thing with social media. Like,
I toured,
thought I was chilling on the beach the whole time. Oh, you're in Ibiza. Yeah, but I landed right before my show. I took a picture and I had to leave right after. People don't see what's going
on. People don't play shows in Ibiza yet. They are chilling at the beach.
It's all closed.
Yeah, so
you still don't know what they're doing. That's I always stay by that. You can't make assumptions based on someone's stories.
Sometimes you can make an educated guess, and 90% of them are really chilling. And that's okay if that's what you want. But
your mic's not working.
Oh, now it's back again.
Oh,
now
it's back again. Yeah. Oh, no. It sometimes is an educated guess, and is it working now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And to be honest, the thing is what I also want. Fucking hell! Oh, I'm playing with the draad. Yeah, is it now working?
Yeah.
You can hear me loud and clear.
Yeah, I can.
Can you not? Yes.
It was funny because just when you started talking again, it went away.
Yeah. Okay. That's also a sign.
Yeah.
Just shut up, Ralph.
Shut up.
No, I know from myself. You can call it ambition or whatever. My socials are boring because I'm always here. Monday to Friday, I'm always here. Don't see me in the gym during the day. Don't see me on the beach during the day. I'm just here because I know I want to go somewhere. I want to achieve stuff. And to be honest, last year, even though it's COVID, we had a hell of a year. And it's all due to the hard work and staying focused. And it comes with a sacrifice. I know also at some point I'm experiencing it. I'm going like, shit, I'm now at the end of my Latin. And it's just, I feel it, the energy, it's all being, and then I reach my limits and I know it, and then that's when I have to. But it's also, you have to put in exceptional effort if you want exceptional things. It's that simple. True. And that's facing all those things, going on social media, because to be honest, you need it. You also need to know what the others are doing. And but you gotta gotta do it like this. Then it's like touring. You tour hard, then you chill hard. You tour hard, then you chill hard. But in this way, it's not gonna work. Yeah. To be honest,
I agree with you. But
no one's gonna say on their deathbed, "Oh, I wish I worked harder. I wish I worked more." I think that's a misconception about giving up everything and not having a private life because I want to reach this goal. And then you reach this goal, and it's like, "Oh my God, I have no friends. I can't share it with anyone." So no, I think it's very important, definitely in this day and age, to not make people think that you have to just work. What I think, what I always did and what worked for me was I know when I have to kick into second gear, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So there's times when I'm in the studio and just I feel like shit, nothing's getting done, so I did all my administrative jobs, and then it's like I can make the whole day full and not produce anything and feel like shit, or I can go to the gym, can go have a walk, and then the next day I know I need to finish stuff and I have deadlines, you make your own deadlines, I kick into the next gear and I work till fucking 12 or whatever just so it's finished. So it's like it's also managing that, and it's very important to not feel like you should be working all the time, because that's what makes you also that you cannot chill hard. You know?
I never have to go into second gear to finish all that stuff. I think that's my basic job. That's what I have to do always. It's also really fun to do, so why not just do it? The second gear is for all the other stuff, whether it's, whatever comes across. You always get chances thrown at you, and you have to recognize them and then step into second gear. Because those chances, they don't come always. Maybe they never come, and maybe they can come all at once. But I feel like now we have a COVID year, everybody has a really bad year. For Bass Checkers, one of the best years ever, money-wise maybe. Or I've done creatively. I mean, we have a new NFT collaboration with a game, Star Atlas. It has Neil Armstrong in there, Space Force, SpaceX. How fucking cool is that? But it wouldn't have happened if I would have gone to the gym 3 days a week during the day and gone to the beach on every other Thursday, for that matter. No, it's pure from the dedication and
but
putting
now,
in the effort.
What did you reach then? Then is it money then? Or that's what I
everything.
Then wonder.
No, I'm proud. I could have never guessed that I would be in a project together with fucking Neil Armstrong. That's cool. Okay. Also on the side, I earn money with it as well. That's a win-win for me. Couldn't get any better than that. And
I honestly think there's no right or wrong way to do this. The only thing that matters, in my opinion, what's important for everyone, if you have the will to work every day or if you have the will to take some time off every now and then, it doesn't matter. There's no right or wrong in that. The only thing that really matters is that you should monitor yourself, that when you are getting, when you are doing too much or when you're noticing that you're going into the reserves and becoming more unhappy. And for that's different for every person. Some people have batteries that can go on for weeks. Some people burn out by working for a week, you know? So it's not a matter of being doing it right or wrong. It's a matter of what works for you.
Well, that's what I said, knowing yourself. That's the most important thing. But I do want to stress out, if you want to reach the main stage, true. I mean, I also notice a lot of people saying, yeah, well, but they're there because they have good connection, this and that. No, that good connection also comes from somewhere. You have to really work it. And I want to stress out, that's the only thing I'm saying. I mean, the only real currency is happiness. That's the only thing you have to strive for. But if you want that big house with that big car like Jay Hardway has, the big ass 5
small
series.
Small house.
And but you have the big car. And I have the big house, to be honest. But if you want that, you have to put in exceptional effort. It's that simple.
Yeah, but a house is just a house. A car is just a car. It's so. But I think that's also a bit how we maybe differ in what we appreciate and value. Like, yes, I would like a big house, but if I see how I grew up and we didn't have. We didn't have no money, of course not. No. But
I'm not saying that's where happiness comes from. But if you
yeah, but I think that's a weird goal to have. What I would love is to excel musically and put something out there that hasn't been done yet. And then I also, you said before, which is kind of true, you should always keep in mind what other people are doing, like other DJs and stuff. But it's also very easy, and that's just to keep in mind, because yeah, you want to know what other DJs are doing, but it's also very easy to get distracted from that and thinking you have to do a certain thing to become famous or whatever. And that's also, if you're listening now, if I listen to Ralph, how he does it, that works for him. If you listen to me, that works for me. And that's exactly what Joey means also with monitoring it. You have to figure out what works for you and what makes what outcome works for you as well.
It's not even that one single way works for one single person. If I look at myself, like I said, I mean, I 100% agree with Joey. You know when you're reaching your limits. It's about being true to yourself, but you always go in flows. It never goes stationary. And you have those low times, and you have those high pressure times, and that's when you just need to feel how you work. And the thing is, it's not going to come easy. That's all I'm saying. It's,
no, not at all.
It's always the hard way. There you have it.
yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And that's all I'm saying. And I don't say that a big house makes you happy or a big car. I mean, whatever you want, you want. I'm not judging about that. To be honest, I don't drive a really expensive car. There's more money in my walls than there's on my driveway because I more care more about the environment and the isolation of my house. And it's whatever drives you. But a lot of people, and I see it everywhere and how they talk, they are reaching for those goals. And if you want those, that's perfectly fine. But then you have to remember, you have to put in a lot of effort and you're gonna reach your limits. That's just like how gravity works. That's gonna happen. And if you're not ready to do that, then don't strive for those things, because you didn't. The chances of you reaching that are gonna be so slim.
Yeah. Maybe I can give you an example of my own, as in when I used to be a DJ, like I had the same goal as you had, like working my ass off, everything, sitting in the studio, good weather, bad weather, I was there. Like 9 to 5, I was in the studio. Which paid off. But when I burned out, I started thinking, like, what actually makes me happy? Aside from music, like, what makes me happy? How do I want my life to be that puts me in a position that I can become happy? Ever since then, I started working 4 days a week. By making that decision, I know that my chances of becoming the world's biggest well-known coaching business are going down, because I can't spend that much hours to it. But that's also not my goal. So I'm aware of the fact that by lowering the amount of work also gives me a different outcome, but I'm okay with that. And I think that that's the most important thing for a person to realize, that if you are looking for a certain outcome, you should realize the consequences of that. Yeah. If you are aiming for Tomorrowland main stage, you know that you have to work your ass off. If you are aiming for just making a decent 2 to 3,000 euros a month by music, well, you can chill, you know, you can do like 4 days a week.
To be honest, that's already hard. Yeah,
that's already hard enough, but still. You can manage to do that by like uploading a lot of stuff on Spotify, doing some content on Twitch, and before you know it, you make 2 to 3,000 euros a month.
Yeah.
But that's not the same goal. So your actions need to match your goals. And Definitely. That's important to realize for everyone, I think.
Yeah.
No, I realize that when you reach your goals, that's the next challenge, because what then?
Oh man, that's so true.
And
as
it's
well.
it's very difficult because it was like my dream to play Tomorrowland, and it happened so fast for me. And I was like, oh shit! Now I need you. You always want to strive for something. Mm-hmm. Also with music, so it's like realize that after your goal. It's like if you want to get a girl, a certain girl, that's step one, or you want to get married, it seems like, oh, it's going to be happily ever after. No, that's just the start. And after that, it goes on, you know? So, and I think that's also with Hartwell becoming number one. It's like, yeah, now what, you know? That's why I also quit, you know, like why I also quit temporarily.
I really respect how he has done it. I mean, he worked his ass off from a young age. And he worked hard. He made his hours. And then he said it until some point, dude, and he knows himself. I think he's like the, for me, he's the blueprint of how you should be. Mm. He knew what makes him happy and what doesn't make him happy, and that's all that counts in the end. But yeah, if you're ambitious, yeah, I mean, he was like, oh man, I could listen to him for hours when he spoke as well. Yeah.
He was always working, like even when you were in the bar at night having a night off, he was still talking about music and things that he could do, and I was.
But also guys like Kashmir, he knew what path he wanted to make. And man, that guy just worked. I thought he was so fucking annoying when I worked with him because the guy was on all the time. And I know for myself that I can work. I can make my hours. But those guys, it's not a big surprise that they are the top, you know.
It's a different species.
Yeah, and also, yeah, there are so many good examples of that. Guys who are always on. But also, to be honest, the guy like Dimitri Vegas, I can mail, text him whenever, and the guy is there. It's sick.
Yeah,
are there 15 Dimitri Vegas guys out there? I don't know how he does it. Yeah.
I always have the thing where I respect it. I respect people who work their ass off, but I also always feel like, dude, take some time off, take out the
but
boat,
maybe that works
have
for them.
Some fun.
Yeah,
I know, but like, it's like, it's not, and I think we shouldn't, or what I do is I don't see that as like, you work 24/7, and then it's like, I don't really, I respect it in some way, but I think I lean more towards not necessarily finding it an achievement, if you know what
no,
I mean.
No, but so all I'm like, saying is there is a correlation between the amount of success, and you can also say success is not that success is being happy. Okay, but let's keep it at being successful in the dance scene. There's a definite correlation with hours and work.
Yeah, compare passion. It to learning to play guitar. If you want to be a really good guitarist, all you have to do is put in the hours. So definitely.
There's a great book about this, which is called
This is the circle,
Seriously, books, always read a lot of books.
There's one of my favorites, which is called Tribe of Mentors, which is not really like a story to read, but it's actually a collection of 100 interviews with a lot of successful people. And successful, I mean someone that has achieved something in life. So you could say the Dalai Lama, Gary Vaynerchuk is in there, Oprah's in there, a lot of different types of successful people. And they asked all those people the same questions. And it's just like a brief interview, like I believe it's 5 to 10 questions. And if you go through that book and read all those people's stories, there's one big red line going through all those stories. Everyone worked their ass off. And everyone failed 100 times before they had one success. And it's so amazing for me to read all those stories. And there literally is a blueprint in front of you how to become successful. It's not a hidden formula or something. It's well known.
Well, it's not how to become successful, but how to increase your chances really much. And because the best plans, they don't succeed, and sometimes the worst plans, they get the success. And that's
but also you can have that blueprint, but I think you can do it the same for, and you never hear the people that fail, that work their ass off, put in everything, put away everyone in their lives, and failed, we will never hear of them. And that's the danger. I think we talked about this last time as well. So be aware, there are, for every Oprah, there's a million girls failing. And now maybe having a shitty job or whatever. So it's
it depends on what you mean with failing. Like maybe they're not Oprah, but maybe they have achieved like creating a life for themselves where they make enough money to do what they like to do. And yeah, they're not like, as famous, but still.
Failing, of course, that's a vague term. But let's say hard to make ends meet. And I don't say that's failing, but it's something where you don't want to be, especially when you just put all your private life aside.
Yeah, true.
And you were, as a kid growing up, not having friends because you were focused on music, you know. Yeah. So it's and talent is also a thing where some people can work and work and work and work. You can't.
I think Messi. He didn't practice free kicks, and he's one of the best.
Yeah,
and look at Ronaldo. He works talent. His ass off.
You can't fake and or buy talent, and I think that's also. Sometimes it's difficult because someone sends a demo and there's a whole story about how they worked for years and years and years, and you hear the demo, and you're like, if that's your result after 5 years, then I'm sorry, you don't have the talent. So maybe find.
I hope you had fun making it.
Yeah. That's very important for sure. But it's like I don't have talent for football. I think Ralph knows this. I realized.
Know. Not judging. I saw
Ralph's
some qualities
team.
In
Wait,
there.
Ralph doesn't judge. Ralph's football team, I'm still known as, if you want to, like, like this is what happens if they're searching for another player, that like a substitute or someone extra.
Yeah.
They always joke about, hey, bring Jobke. And it's they mean it as a joke, and they would really be very angry if I actually showed up.
the guy who invited Jobke is our manager, the same manager, and he didn't put himself in the same team as Jobke. And he still gets good heat for that. But to be honest, you can't blame yourself. They're all guys who played soccer for like 25 years already. So, hey, big surprise. I didn't, because you made up a lot of with just effort, and it also gave you some kind of a drive. So, some points, Jobke actually made a good difference. And I think that also, if you don't, hey, know yourself. I know from myself, I'm not the most talented music guy out there, but I make up for it with hard work and knowing myself, knowing where I'm good at. And if I don't know stuff, I just ask the guys who I know that know it. And I think it's just all about knowing yourself, whether it comes from pressure or like the talent you lack or whatever. Know yourself, be honest about it. Don't be the person you think you are. We all have this self-image we strive for. That's
you
why
want to
we
be the person
yeah you want
to
be yeah that's why we buy the clothes or the car or whatever, right? We all have that self-image and we strive for that, but in the meantime we are a certain person that has certain intrinsic motivators or limitations and whatever. And that's why you need to be honest, because that usually doesn't correspond.
In your relationships with anyone, if it's your girlfriend or your parents or your friends, try to also listen to, if you have a fight or whatever, it's so important to listen to that feedback and realize what kind of a person you are. I know I can be very annoying and like very high energy and stuff, but if I know that, I can work with it. So it's not that I can suppress it. Or not always, you know. So I can still be very annoying, but at least I realize it and I know, like, to say, "Yeah, sorry, I'm annoying sometimes." That's what I do.
There's a nice sentence that I've learned, which really helps me in this, and I have to say this correctly. The reaction of your communication is the result of what you communicated.
Yeah? Okay, so, this was the show for this week.
Let me explain this. the how someone reacts, how someone responds to you after you said something, that's the reaction you wait, I have to Google the provoked right English or... version because
you lost me, man.
Yeah.
Time for some coffee.
Okay, you guys you guys talk, I'll look it up.
I think it might be something like
nice t-shirt. What's on your belly?
It's AMC.
AMC. Oh yeah, I got it. Yeah. What's what does the A stand for?
I have no idea. But I think what you kind probably mean is that you already have some kind of idea in mind what's how someone will respond, and that is exactly what you bring into that conversation.
It has to do that you can learn from the response of the other person. So if you try to bring a message to that person, but probably you did something wrong, or you created a different result with that person, maybe by your tone of voice, or maybe by the energy you, the way how you brought it, how you brought the message, because you can say, someone died. Or you can say, hey, someone died. Same sentence, different way of communication. And you get a different response from that person, and you can learn from that person from the response you get. I'm looking it up. I lost you guys.
Totally fine. I understand. I understand. I understand.
Get it, to be honest.
I really need to get the English.
But you can also say, hey, or, hey.
Yeah. Or, hey, would you like to please clean your room? You know, like, it's a mess. Please clean your room.
I saw this really funny quote.
Please fucking clean your room. Same message, different way of bringing it.
Hey, whoa. You don't have to yell, Joey.
Yeah, exactly.
I saw this really funny meme. It was on 9gag. And it's about, like, hooking up with girls and stuff. And it said, like, stop thinking that you're ugly. And then... that's the first line, and there's like a space, and it says, "You're still ugly, but stop thinking about it." And it's like funny because if you think you're ugly, you will portray that even more.
Yeah. That's so
if you're
true.
Not, if you're not as good looking as me, you know. no, but like that's actually true with a lot of conversations. You have to. That's also, I think, what confidence is like. Yeah, you gotta stop thinking about your negatives and work with your positives sometimes.
True.
Glass half full.
I've got the sentence.
You switched me around, Ralph. It's your...
I know.
Okay. The meaning of your communication is the response you get. Let that sink in.
How can I react to this?
Yeah, just put your thumbs up. Let this sink in, and let's continue next time talking about this, because we've all already, like, it's almost an hour, long enough.
Yeah.
Long enough bullshit.
Yeah.
It actually turned out to be a nice conversation. Thanks.
Yeah.
Thank you. We touched a lot of topics.
The meaning of the podcast is the response of the YouTube comment. So if you... please respond, comment, and like.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, guys, see you next time.
See you next time, guys. Stay positive.